Welcome everyone to another Laika sort of Laika Link Entertainment movie. This one was technically their first, even though they don't have full credit. Made on September 9 of 2009, this movie is simply called, well, Nine. Directed by Shane Acker. I don't know who he is, Dweebs, if you can do your magic.
Shane Acker, he is a filmmaker.
Yeah, and with talented actors as Christopher Plummer, Martin Landau, John C. Reilly, Crispin Glover, Jennifer Connelly, Fred Tatasciore, Elijah Wood, and others. Basically, this is a weird animation movie, believe me.
Oh, hold on, let me just interrupt for a moment.
The Italian film.
Let me just interrupt you for a moment too. I just found something. Apparently, the people who a lot of the staff who worked on this movie did eventually leave and form Laika. That's how it started. Oh, there you go.
Okay. But yeah, basically this was a weird movie project. I don't even know if it's based on an existing novel or something. But in any case, it tells a really interesting tale set in a post-apocalyptic future. You will see for yourself. And it's surprisingly short, but
yeah,
it does its job for what it does. Right. So if it's already starts before the Focus thing logo.
Focus features.
Focus features.
Let's get this started.
All right, 3, 2, 1, click.
All right, so from this information, now I know that officially Laika has never made a bad movie. Box Trolls was decent, but not bad. But aside from that, I've enjoyed the heck out of Coraline and the Paranorman.
I wouldn't even call Box Trolls bad, really.
No, it's not bad. It's not bad. It's just really average and forgettable.
Funnily enough, Paige, while you were gone, Joba told me that apparently this film has a bit of a divisive thing among
It does. Basically, a lot of people didn't like the minimalistic approach to the story.
Apparently it was based on a short made before, and decided to make it a full-length movie.
Yep. Also, fun fact, this movie came out in 2009. Guess what other movie came out in 2009? An Italian meta film called Nine.
So is this the Italian ripoff of Nine made by Vincent Don?
I
actually
don't know.
No. This is a movie that premiered in London has to do with basically a musical drama meta film.
The other nine
on
was
an
from
Italian.
There you go, Dweebs. Here's the critics' consensus. Although its story is perhaps too familiar and less complex than some might wish, Nine is visually spectacular, and the director Shane Acker's attention to detail succeeds in drawing viewers into the film's universe. Basically, the main complaint is that the story is too simple for its own good.
Alright. Basically, Shane Acker, he's directed a couple of short films, The Hangnail and The Astounding Talent of Mr. Grenade. He also worked on the visual effects for Lord of the Rings, Return of the King.
Oh. So basically the whole thing about Legolas one-shotting an elephant on its own, that seemed to blame.
He also worked on the animation for Journey 2, The Mysterious Island, the 2012 Total Recall remake, Oz the Great and Powerful, and 47 Ronin.
Nice.
47 Ronin?
I don't know what that movie is, but let's talk about
the other stuff. Tell me.
Oh, yeah, any of you. One more thing about the other nine. You may love the tagline for that movie. This holiday season, be Italian.
Oh, fuck. Anyway.
All Italians everywhere.
Roll credits.
Anyway, yeah. A fun fact about this movie. The first time I watched it was completely at random, by the way. I discovered it by basically chance. And it was on a streaming site. But for some reason, the copy I watched had the voices kinda altered, the sound altered up until pretty much the halfway through. But I didn't recognize it, so I always thought the characters were speaking in a weird manner. But the way the movie is told, at least for the first half, it created this weird ambiguity where the voices seemed to fit even though they were a bit distorted. So, there's that.
This is a bit weird. The movie trailer seemed to suggest that the guys would be larger, not like tabletop size.
Maybe you watch the short?
Well, I watched the trailer. I kind of recall the whole tabletop starting. Like, this is literally my first time actually getting to watch this movie in full. I was interested, you know.
Well,
I go and.
Oh, well, no, this
Trump,
movie.
Well, this, Trump election got way out of its way.
Wait, isn't this London?
This is Crisis City. Dun, 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 dun,
so basically, dun, this guy looks like the gingerbread man if he were made in Little Big Planet.
So take your pick, audience. Is this America after Trump becomes president, or is it Britain after Brexit?
You see, no, you see, Dwight, what happened here is Media Molecule, someone at Media Molecule did a lot of weed, and this is the result.
Yeah.
I see.
Oh, so this is British.
And don't worry, guys. If you heard me, if you heard a can opening in the background, don't worry. It's not cider.
Also, this is 9, played by Elijah Wood.
Yep. Ouchie.
Sorry.
A lot of Lord of the Rings people. A lot of Lord of the Rings people in this movie.
Oh, hey, you having fun, kids?
Revolt. Yeah. By the way, this is not a kids movie.
Yeah. Even though I'm sure a lot of parents took their kids to see it because, hey, Nightmare Before Christmas.
It's starting to remind me a bit of the post-apocalyptic setting of WALL-E. Where are we going to start playing 1940s music?
Well, the magic about WALL-E is that the post-apocalyptic world they built in, it's, how can I say, it's... not squat, no, but it gives the impression that it's not as... bad as you can imagine. Yes, humanity is not there and the world is in ruin, but you don't really mind because you see WALL-E doing all this funny stuff.
Oops.
Hello there.
The screenwriter for this movie is Pamela Petler.
What did she write?
Some TV stuff, including CBS Summer Playhouse, All About Us, and an episode of Saved by the Bell. She also wrote an episode of Mary Kate and Ashley in Action. She also wrote the screenplays for Corpse Bride and Monster House.
So yeah, 9 doesn't have a voice, so of course we need to give it one.
9 is the last thing that she did as of now.
So what are the main complaints people bring up with this movie?
The story being too simplistic.
Ah.
Ew.
Yeah, wonder what a lot of kids thought when their parents brought them to see this movie.
Oh my god, Elijah Wood spoke.
Yeah, he did.
Subtle.
Is that Christopher Plummer voice in that guy?
I think so. I didn't check his number, but
yes, it is actually. I just checked it. Yeah, it's Christopher Plummer. Good one, Jova.
Mm.
There's also Martin Landau, John C. Reilly, Crispin Glover, Jennifer Connelly. They got a really great cast for this movie.
Yeah,
I'll say.
Here we go. While the movie was well liked by audiences and gained a large fan following, I mean, it's of TV tropes, critic responses were more mixed, with many criticising the movie's writing and short length. All right. Wait, Nightmare on Elm Street now?
Yikes.
Wait. It's the Spectre! Oh, no.
Ah!
What the heck even are those? Oh, wait.
That reminds me
Who knows?
What's that? That reminds me of the Neverbirds in Pan. the design, anyway.
For me, this is actually my second time watching this, and I don't remember much of it, so I'm almost fresh again.
Oh no! Dogs, which would be harmless to humans if they were alive, but are dangerous to our protagonists.
Yeah.
Is this film computer animated?
Yes, it is.
Okay. Do it. Oh.
Yikes.
Hashtag thanks to Ibs.
Well, shoot. Oh, well, he's still alive, I guess.
Oh, well.
Oh, well,
Well, crud.
Big Brother is what?
Actually, the one Nine just met was number 2 and was played by Martin Landau. We have to meet the one played by Christopher Plummer. Yeah.
That one's 5.
Yeah, 5 is played by John C. Reilly. And there's Christopher Plummer.
Literally douche much.
Yeah, he's gonna be our leader with,
Well, this is a better movie to be in rather than Rockadoodle.
Yeah, true.
Oh yeah, he was in that.
Rockadoodle?
Yes, the movie that destroyed Don Bluth's career.
Yeah.
No. That wasn't the movie that destroyed his career.
I thought it was Saturday E.
Well, the thing is, technically he was just the nail in the coffin, basically.
Rockadoodle was something that started stuff. I wouldn't say really destroyed. I mean, Rockadoodle is bad, but not god-awful to the point of some other...
Central Park, I guess. Okay, basically, Rockadoodle was people cutting off his legs, and Troll in Central Park was the shot to the head.
What was Anastasia, then?
And yes, as per tradition, Fred Tatasciore voice is a big guy.
Of course.
Anastasia was them trying to, do CPR on him, but it didn't work out.
Off we go. Into a church?
Yeah, I'm starting to remember. I'm starting to remember. Ooh.
What the hell?
My phone.
Mute, please. Anyway, yeah, I'm starting to remember one of my main gripes of this movie is that it takes quite a while for the movie to, take off, per se. Mm-hmm. I mean, so far we haven't really learned anything about these characters. There you go. Oh yeah, I remember this. Doesn't he know this already? I mean, I get that you have to explain this to the audience, but I don't know.
Nine doesn't remember.
Ah, okay.
Reveal is gonna be later on.
All right, sure. Hey, Teo.
Yeah?
War is hell.
Of course. Whee! Ouch.
Drop down your weapons. You have 20 seconds to comply.
This is basically what happened in the Terminator continuity where the machine won. Come on. All right. Oh. Stop questioning me.
Don't ask questions.
Now we're in the sixth sense, I think. Or was it, what was the movie, the one with the...
Oh, no, actually, this reminds me a lot... Yeah, this actually reminds me a bit more of number 13, with the thing on the wall.
And oh, the... I mean the one where with Jim Carrey.
Yeah. All right.
Don't you know I'm an Elijah Wood? I have the spirit of adventure in my veins.
Okay, have I missed anything?
Basically, number one of those is a bit of a dick, and has basically said to Nine, just stay here, don't cause trouble, blah, 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 blah. And don't ask questions, basically. But Nine wants to go and rescue two, and is having five tag along with him.
Hey, what I miss?
Basically, the leader of a group is a dick, Nine wants to do his own way, and has brought five with him.
Yeah.
Oh, so we haven't met any of the other numbers yet?
Only eight, which is the, you know, the usual big guy with a sword that functions as the muscle of a group.
Was this game a prequel to Mighty Number 9?
No.
No.
You're very funny, Dwibs. That's why I'm gonna kill you last.
Yeah. Let me guess, you lied.
Nah, I'm telling the truth.
So now we're in...
Oh yes, and the reason the world is like this is because there have been a war... Basically the same as Terminator, a war between man and machine.
So this is like... Shit. I just realized.
Yeah.
We're in a post-apocalyptic world where it's mostly sand, and this came out in 2009. It's Terminator Salvation.
Yeah, only done better. What time are you guys at?
19 and 18, 8, 9, 10, 11. Go to 19 and
30. Right. Come on. Anytime now, movie. I mean, Bob Locker. Okay, I'm paused at 1942.
All right, you're almost there.
And click.
There we go.
Yay! Let there be light.
Yeah, also, Adam's Family reference.
They're creepy and they're cookie, mysterious and spooky.
Is that going to fall to everybody going to sing Pinky and the Brain?
I was going for the Adam's Family theme.
Jay Java, what do you want to do tomorrow night?
The same thing we always do, Pedro. Take over the world.
Alright.
Okay, so far, this movie, while not exactly bad, not exactly,
Not much has happened, I guess.
Yeah, to be fair, it's not that...
It's the pace, mostly.
Yeah, technically, stuff is happening, it's just that it doesn't feel very impactful, because, one, the characters aren't as developed as they should be, And
we're 20 minutes in and we haven't even met all the 9 characters yet. I mean,
My main problem with this movie is that, aside from the pacing, like Theo mentioned, the pacing could be a bit better. Couldn't you at least establish these two characters before we start this journey? I don't know. It just feels like it just feels like there's like a missing, like the writers were just concerned about the actual journey itself rather than getting us to know the characters.
That, and anyone who's not seen the trailers will kind of be in the dark on the premise, because I know from the trailers that the premise is
in the dark, and we're in the dark.
Yeah, it's very cool. Anywho, but yeah, oh, also, that thing looks like a 9 on the light bulb. Cute.
Roll credits. Also,
huh?
Roll credits. Ding!
But yeah, Nicole, speaking as someone who saw the trailers, I get what the premise is about, 9 creatures created to save the world by whatever means necessary. But going off of the movie so far, we've just heard the opening narration from their creator saying something about, I don't know, building 9 or something, and then boom,
there was a flashback scene.
What did the flashback tell?
The flashback that explained that showed the war and shit.
And the dolls getting refuge.
Not just that, but...
And now 5 lost his eye, pretty much.
And notice, by the way, how we're literally less than an hour away from the end of the movie anyway, so yeah. We're a third into this, and so far, yeah.
Luckily, I have got some snacks, so...
Well, we're not quite a third in yet, but yeah, we're getting there.
Oh dear. Ah! Oh no, Jova, it's the design that Joe Wright kinda ripped off with Pan.
Yeah, only compared to us, that thing's not so big, because we're human-sized.
Hmm. Ow.
Was Elijah Wood paid to only go, It's like Vin Diesel with Iron Giant and Guardians of the Galaxy.
But Dwibs, We are Groot.
Aww.
Let me guess, a new character 9 just happens to show up.
Yeah. It's if a, I recall correctly, random. It's 7.
It's interesting. What are considered Ben Diesel's best roles are roles where he barely speaks.
Well, Vin Diesel is a very physical actor, so it makes sense.
Yep, she's 7, played by Jennifer Connelly.
Hey, Jenny.
Nice. Eh? Oh, let me guess, this was explained in the flashback.
Not really, no, actually.
Oh, well then, okay, what the heck do you mean you came back?
They figured she was, she went away for some reason, but turns out no.
Do we ever, like, you know, see the, why they fought?
No, not so, not.
It was implied by the fact that one took command, and some of them didn't agree.
Speaking of, I've noticed that each of us have a different recurring aspect of what movies we pick for commentary.
What?
TOs are the ones that are either very obscure or ones that people have forgotten about because it was years ago. Mine have a lot of action in them. Jova's...
I'm more, all around.
Mostly leaning towards the comedy side of things. And Pedro's is... what would you say your overall pick is, Pedro?
The more well-rounded movies?
Did they just kill someone?
Basically, yeah, soul transfer.
Well, actually, those aren't most of my picks bad movies anyway, but, you know.
Yeah. I thought most of my picks were bad movies.
Yeah. Also, Dibs, when it comes to me, I don't go strictly for comedy. I mean, well, I have more of a mix.
I said leaning towards.
So, yeah, they just rescued two. That's the thing, I'm more of an all-around type. Get sucked in.
So, yeah. What was the point of rescuing two, then? You're just going to die 5 minutes later anyway.
Well, 9 didn't knew, that's for sure.
See, so this would be exciting. This would be exciting if I cared about the characters. But the problem is that they don't really develop. I have no idea what even are the differences between each character. I mean, the only trait that 9 has really is that he's rebellious. But that's it.
And also, this chick is good with bows and arrows.
Also, wouldn't it be, you know, a good idea to, you know, have all 9 of the characters, you know, be together in a scene, but that doesn't seem possible now because 2 is dead.
He's dead.
Unless it's just a soul that's taken, and, well, we're gonna get it back somehow.
Okay, I got an Incredibles flashback with that moment there for some reason.
It's because of the eye, isn't
and
it?
And also, it's the bit where...
Wood got spotted by a giant eye. It reminded
me of the bit where Mr. Incredible shouted, "Send James remote!" And he just got attacked.
Yeah. Also, yeah, you're right, Tio. Elijah Wood has bad luck with evil demonic eyes. I guess they're not there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, fucking run.
What time are you coming on Saturday?
Hey, come on. I just want to talk.
Skynet is pissed.
I really do have to wonder what the builder was thinking, making them that small and helpless.
Well, it's gonna be kinda revealed during the, you know, reveal moment.
Yeah.
There? I'm sorry,
remember, it's Stein who put the finger magic in the place.
So. Now, let's go into the obvious evil tower of death.
Actually, okay, we just escaped from it.
Okay. Let me guess. It turns out that that machine was supposed to take two souls, and that's all part of the algorithm or something to save the world.
You'll see.
All right. Also, oil digging. Of course.
Oil, the source of everything.
We will get oil.
Yikes.
Wow, even bones are a reusable resource.
Dwebs, if we're gonna do that
montage.
Dwebs, if we're gonna do that, mute.
What about all the times that you haven't muted about when you did stuff like this, Pedro?
Wait, what? When have
either way, though, that's no excuse not to mute, Dwebs.
When have I ever done some kind
I thought it wouldn't be that loud.
Whatever.
Because I was having it away from the mic, but whatever. So now we're looking at
a painting.
Nice painting. I'm gonna look.
Eh.
Diva.
Actually, she said keep up.
I thought she said diva.
She says that a lot. Keep up. Do these, is there supposed to be some gimmick where they each repeat a word often?
No. But it's kind of like that because, you know, each one has their own personality traits.
True.
They do? No,
these are 3 and 4, if I can recall, yeah.
The twins, I guess?
Yeah.
Oh!
Yeah.
Are they going to be like Tate and Lisa from Pokemon Gen 3 / the remake where they finish each other's sentences or something?
Nah. They don't talk, actually.
Ooh, a light bulb.
But basically, yeah, their job is to catalog things.
Why 2 for that? Weird.
Yeah, the machine!
Machines!
Machines!
Traffic case.
Amazing. You know,
this all looks very. Oh, wait, is this exposition?
Brain.
Of course.
Basically, these are your hints about what happened. Subtle!
Wait, Nazis?
Nope. Communists.
Oh, communists. So, Russia?
Pretty much.
Okay, something's up with my player. Jover, are you using VOD Locker on yours?
Yep.
Or I'll just go to VOD Locker then.
Oh my god, AT-ATs.
Yep, pretty much. This is a scenario where Cold War escalated so much due to men discovering how to create robots.
And what do you know? The machines turned against them.
Obviously.
No, seriously, those are AT-ATs.
Basically, yeah, it's a scenario of... It's like the Terminator scenario, although everything has gone bad.
Alright, Joe, what time are you at on your video?
32, 37, 38, 39,
40. Okay.
And counting.
I'll just go to...
33 minutes.
It's loading, so I can pause, I can give you a... so I can confirm a time.
Yeah.
They don't know.
33:37 is where I'm at.
Alright.
Got it. So I guess 9's the thinker.
Actually, 9 is the pretty much the, you know, jack of all trades. So.
Ah. Of course, because he's the 9th one, so he's the mightiest one.
Of course. James, the time you're at 33 and...
37.
Alright, we're almost there.
Hey, Joe, I made that joke earlier.
So, what exactly is Seven's specialty? I never caught on this. You like the most nimble one, the swashbuckler?
Hold on, give me a second. And Weebs, get ready, and click. There. Basically, Seven, she's the one who wants to... It's almost like Nine, but in a more incomplete way. She wanted to explore and discover what was going on, but couldn't manage to do much about it.
Ah, so she's the explorer type.
Yeah. And since this was contradicting one's dogmas or whatever he established, that's why she was gone.
Uh-huh.
Well, busted.
Oh, hey, Eight. Well, he's not the oldest.
And this one is 6, which is pretty much the sensitive.
The recluse.
Basically, he paints what he visions. Yikes.
So he's the prophet.
Kinda.
Boy, infighting.
Because why not?
Yeah.
Ooh, sick burn.
Well, considering the world around you, I wouldn't say fear is unwarranted.
And here's our next robot of the day.
The Black Falcon.
Kinda. Is there any Transformers Predacon, Jova, that you know, but it's kinda like that?
Yeah. He also reminds me of laser beacons certain continuities.
Ow. Whee!
Well, I guess they're machines, so they don't have to worry about rope burn.
Or falling damage.
Yeah, that actually is a good question. If they can't feel damaged, why don't they just jump?
Well, that's
then again, also machinery.
That's also part of reveal, sort of.
Okay.
All right. Oh, there you go.
Boom, fans shot.
Oh, Buster Sword.
Yeah.
AKA a scissor.
Uh-oh.
Let's see what you did, Nine. You broke Calibrus. How are we supposed to defeat the Moonbear King now?
Boy, that came in handy.
Yep.
Nope.
Wee.
Yeah. Oh.
Oh. Well, fucked.
Nope.
Yeah.
The cable.
All right.
Well, it's a hook, so I don't have much trouble with that.
We there we go.
And off goes the fan.
Let the cape go.
Oh boy.
Symbolism. And boom. Oh, well.
There's another thing to remind me of Incredibles. No capes!
Yep.
Also, hey, people wanted their fan service, and that's what they got. Also, random burning building.
Actually, it was because the pterodactyl broke in and now the church was burning.
Yeah.
I guess I'm not paying attention.
So are any humans even alive or is it literally just
machines?
No.
Everyone pretty much died, Drova. It's a post-apocalyptic world in every kind of sense.
Makes you wonder, I mean, is there really much worth saving at this point?
Well, remember, just because we aren't men doesn't mean we're, you know, you can't fight for life itself. And remember, the gas kills everything.
But if this is a post-apocalyptic world, where are all the crazy people riding motorcycles and cars fighting over fuel? George Miller lied to me.
Well, there are several types of apocalypse in our world.
Yeah, and don't even get me started on the Hulk kind. Ugh. But yeah, I mean, like, well, can like anything come back to life if they defeat the machines, I wonder?
Well, you'll see.
Actually, I have to wonder what the bad guy's evil plan is yet, or do we have to figure that out later as well?
Well, the brain is pretty much building machines, constantly building machines, but he knows that the nine, the puppets are pretty much his only obstacle, so he needs to get rid of them first.
Even that one that's dead, apparently.
Alright. Well, what a dick.
Yeah.
Ding!
Oh, look, a disembodied hand.
What have we accomplished so far in this movie?
Basically, two got killed, and... this party is always rich. Basically, guess what this represents, Drova?
Oh, God. Hi. He's getting high off of magnetism.
Yep, pretty much.
In case you haven't noticed at this point, parents, this isn't a kid's movie.
Basically, what they need is the thingamajig that the other dolls were searching. Nine found it, but accidentally plugged in into the main machine, and that reactivated the brain. But here's pretty much the, you know, transmutata vitae, basically life transmutation. Basically transferring your soul into something else.
Let me guess, Latin.
Yeah.
Well, it created you.
Yeah, how dare you ask questions?
Dang. You're a crap leader. Dude, if it was
So far, this isn't really grabbing me. All we've got here are the good guys. I can't really tell them apart because they all seem the same personality-wise. And King Dickhead.
Not really.
Dwibs. I'm not exactly being grabbed by this movie, but you're really wrong when you're saying that they all have the same personality. I mean, 9's the explorative one. 7 is the rambunctious, but, you know, keep up one. 1's the ticker slater. The two silent twins, they're the silent types, but they're the ever curious types. 6's the recluse, and 8's, well, 8's the brute.
Well, even in that case, then, there's still not a whole lot of that going around, really, is there?
Actually, there is enough to at least tell them apart. I mean, I dare say it's not really fair to call them one and the same. I mean, at most, maybe you could say 9 and 2 are similar, but some of that's only because that we've seen so little of 2.
And here's our next monster of the week. Yeah.
I think the main problem is that the characters never actually stop for more than a minute to have an actual deep conversation about who they are.
Or have a bit of development.
Yeah, that does not help.
All they've talked in so far are either one-liners or talking to King Douche McNick, King Douchey.
Yeah, the writer is more like concerned on the state of the world and the fact that they have to do what they have to do, rather than actually, you know, helping us get to know the characters. And without
you're
that,
a crap sack world, get out of it. The end.
What the?
It's our next monster of the week, Drova. Guess what animal it represents?
A snake.
Well, how do you guess?
Wow, me and Jova got it right. You will kill your friends.
Or just stand still long enough for me to kill you, apparently. Well, it left 8 alive.
Hans Zimmer stepped in, apparently.
No, away. Please, don't flash me.
Yeah.
And here comes 7 to the rescue.
Of course.
Yeah, she seems to do that a lot.
There you go. Well, shit.
Snake, use your snake stare.
Or the scissors.
Oh.
Also, Dwibs, you kind of disabled the snake stare.
I mean, the movie's called 9 because obviously 9 is the main character. But aside from 9...
Should have been called 9 because they were focusing on all 9 of them you'd have fought.
Yeah, the thing... It's called 9, so obviously 9 is the one who was the most character in terms of he's the one who was, of course, the first one to be against number 1's things. Well, aside from maybe, whatever. In the context of the movie itself, 9 is, of course, the one going against number 1's leadership. The problem is that the other characters are basically just going along with the ride.
A nine is what some critics said to this movie. You know, nine. Yeah. Get it? Nine. Yes. No.
Whatever.
Look at 3 and 4, for example. If 3 and 4 actually spoke.
No,
they're the mutes. They can't speak.
They do this, but they do it about by showing what they get a lot.
Who voiced that guy who's that character who just died?
Actually, that was the corpse of 2.
Yeah.
Oh no, 2. How will I ever cope without him?
He's already been dead, Dwibs. We had our time to mourn, not now.
He's already dead, Dwibs.
Stop! He's already dead! Oh wait, no, never mind. We're having a funeral for him now.
Dear people, we are gathered here to remember the long memory of 2. He was...
Okay, yeah, little rip, Dwibs. I mean, honestly, the movie hasn't quite earned this, yes. I'm sorry to say.
We are here to be gathered for the death of 2.
Not really, no.
He was
I mean, don't get me wrong. This movie has really great artistic direction and all that stuff, and the music is pretty good too. It's just that the movie doesn't really have the emotional depth to back it up. Really, it's a pretty movie that's honestly very shallow.
His legacy.
And the real shame is like, well, they
put more in our hearts. Because that's the only thing to remember by. I can't even remember what he was like. Anyway, funeral over. Refreshments in the main hall.
Whatever. It's like, well, the main issue is like, well, he could have actually been a character we memorized. It's like, well, 20 minutes or not. It's like, well, okay, you could have a character be on time for a short time, but if you build up that character in a short time, then by all means, I'll care. The problem is like, well, 2 was literally there to just be the first other creation that Nine would meet, and then later die when Nine accidentally slipped up. So yeah, as far as we know right now, Nine is technically responsible for his death, which kind of makes it harder for me to care.
That's interesting, Jonah, because another one of my film picks also has a character who we barely know until that person dies.
In Mission Impossible, I mean, Expendables 2?
No.
Well, awesome.
Honestly, Jabba, I would argue they did a better job of developing the kid character in Expendables 2 better than they did in this movie, honestly. I mean, they gave him a girlfriend and everything. I mean, I mean, don't get me wrong, it wasn't Shakespeare or anything, but considering the kind of movie it was fun enough.
I'll bring that movie up when we get to that one, Jabba.
I wasn't saying that, like, oh, it's bad. In fact, I was saying it's like, oh, it's another movie that just does something similar, not necessarily does it bad.
Now, look at your friend. What number is he again?
That one is eight.
He was one of the more unique ones, dang it.
Wait, are they going to fire the Death Star at him? Oh.
No, he's going to absorb his soul too.
So he's a Dementor.
So number...
Not kidding.
Number 8. Oh, yeah, number 8. Would you help me climb to the top of this tower so I can free the village?
There's one small problem with that, Pedro.
And that is?
He dead.
Aww.
So, they're getting rid of 8 and 7, which to me were some of the more unique characters. Just great.
So, that's kind of backwards, though. You don't kill off your best characters.
Unless you're George R. Martin.
Well, yeah, that's Game of
Thrones. Well, that depends. That depends. Sometimes the best characters are probably the ones that die exactly because of the fact that they are great characters. Like, let's say, for example, hold on.
Wolverine in the comics.
Not just and that.
And boom.
Yeah.
Joyful.
Okay, they didn't kill off 7. Great. Just great. Let me go in there, movie.
Like, well, let's say you haven't seen Up, so you wouldn't know.
Again, that was during my Pixar hiatus.
Okay. Actually, no, that's a bad idea. Never mind, ignore me. I'll think of something else.
Paul!
Well, shit.
Let go.
Raid.
Oh, that'll work. Uh-oh.
Discount Sentinels.
I think we should go.
They are going.
Come on, one. Do something useful for a change. Jesus Christ, who the fuck elected this moron a leader? He's a shit leader.
Yeah.
Am I supposed to like this guy? He's been nothing but a dick.
And no, you're not.
I'm pretty sure you're not, Dwibs.
I'm guessing you're not supposed to, despite him being number one. Oh, now he's helping. Oh, I get it. Good momentum. Quite an interesting plan. Blow him up.
Oh,
shit!
Okay, that was funny. So, yeah, problem solved, I guess.
Well, we still have, 20 minutes into the movie, so...
Jeez, this movie has been breezing fast. And we have what? Just seven of the 9 alive.
Yeah, it goes back to what I was saying. Yeah, not only is it 80 minutes long, it's always on the move. We're always moving from one place to another. And the movie never really stops to breathe. You know, let us get to know these people. Let us absorb the atmosphere. We're just constantly on the move.
And for the record,
look, another place burning.
And for the record, we have not had any scene with all 9 of the alleged 9 on screen. So I guess we get 20 minutes of a good future then. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, really? Wow, you had the victory music prepared and everything.
Love the song.
A lot of stuff I've seen.
Yeah, now it's really reminding me of WALL-E.
A lot of stuff that I've seen uses that theme tune.
Somewhere Over the Rim is one of the most iconic songs of all time.
Life on Mars used that song.
Mm-hmm.
Romance?
I actually know a Brazilian. Just give me, here's an idea, Dwibs. I actually know of a Brazilian soap opera that used it as its main theme. Again, it's a theme that pretty much everybody knows. Like, it's such an iconic piece of music.
Oh, he's just misunderstood.
Sorry, it's a bit too late for me to start trying to care about this guy.
Well, I guess the confrontation's over, so we don't have much reason to care.
Hang on, wait, who died?
No, nobody eight. Died. Eight. Well, aside from eight, yeah.
Who died?
Well, eight was just the dumb one, so there.
Wait. Yeah, but he could do a lot of cool moves, and he actually had something of a different character that actually diversified him.
Okay, guys, I just thought of a fun little game I've had in my head.
What?
I imagine these characters, because they're numbered from 1 to 9, I'm imagining them as manifestations of Final Fantasy games.
Well, actually,
Hey, it makes sense. 9 and 7 seem to be the best characters alive at the moment.
Actually, now that you think about it, yes, the numerology is kind of a good analogy for the way this movie was. I mean, let's think about this. They didn't even bother giving them names. They just think, this is character number 1, character number 2, character number 3, character number 4. Like, it's so...
Oh, well, what do you know? He's still alive.
I know. Of course, it's not their intention, obviously, but the fact that they only have names that are numbers kind of reflects the fact that they're one so flat.
Also, what? Also, bye, number 5.
Yep.
Of course it isn't dead yet. I mean, God forbid we have, 20 minutes left to actually focus on them restructuring the world or something. Although I guess we still had that whole plot thing about the thing sucking their souls to maintain or address.
Hmm.
Well, hey, at least it's just that one thing left alive, and it's a shame, just as the sky was starting to clear up.
This movie could have really benefited from a longer running time.
Maybe he didn't have enough budget, though.
Well, but Tim Burton was a producer, so I'm sure they had
$30 million budget.
It depends on how much participation he had in that as well, because producer can be an incredibly fickle position. Like, you can either be a producer to the point where you practically control the thing, or you could just be a producer where
you're... This feels like a movie that was intended to be way longer than it is, but for some kind of restriction, they had to basically strip it down to its bare-bone essentials.
Which is such a shame, because this movie seems to have a lot of potential.
It does have a lot of potential, but it just feels rushed.
Oh, and now Six goes.
Yeah, but it gives
a prophecy.
They're killing off the characters too fast as well.
Well, it could. It's not so much the problem that they're killing them fast. Again, it's the problem that they're flat. I mean, it could work. I mean, one good example that I like to refer to in terms of killing the characters in the group fast is the last few episodes of the first season of Sailor Moon, where basically there's a thing where the characters are kind of quickly dying one by one. But it really works because by that point we've spent 90 episodes of those characters by this point, so we actually do care. With here, not really. So, sorry.
Yeah, for comparison, had the movie spent the first 40 minutes building up all 9 of the characters as a team, I would actually be okay with the other 40 or so minutes actually spent killing them off until there's one left, because by then I would know about them and then I'd be able to feel sorry about them regardless of how quick their deaths were. That's the thing about a character. You make that character an actual person, which makes them capable of caring of. I mean, don't get me wrong. Even in real life, it's I'm going to feel sad, of course, for someone who died. But if it's not someone I know, well, what more do you want me to do than just pay my respects?
I mean, aside from 9 and I guess 7, the characters are
9, 7, and I guess 1 at this point now.
Yeah, aside from 9, 7, and 1, all the characters are pretty much interchangeable.
8 was unique, but they killed him off second to last. 2 was literally 9, just with a cool-looking hat, which he only used once. Oh, look, we're right back where we started.
Is this the reveal, too?
Yeah, we're there.
All right, in that case, let's try to pay attention.
So,
Let's see if the movie manages to redeem itself.
Yep.
I don't even remember. Oh.
Who knows? Maybe there was all purpose.
Is he talking about the movie?
Oh, so he was also the one who created the brain, apparently.
Yeah. But the military...
So it was the military's fault for corrupting him, apparently.
Yeah. So he went with a backup plan.
It's the military's fault, cliche.
Oh, there you go. So apparently 9 parts of his brain he beamed into the 9.
Hold on. Okay. Mm-hmm. Yep. Well, all the puppets have been part of the scientist's soul. That's also why we have one specific character trait, because we represent part of his personality or soul.
Okay, that makes sense. Fair enough. So, what exactly is the big plan, I wonder?
Well, they want him... Hold on. Basically, yeah, he wanted them to, either destroy the big machine, or just, avoid the destruction.
So basically,
he was desperate and couldn't think of anything else.
I wonder what happens if that machine gets its soul, then. Because it seems to be absorbing them.
Symbolism.
So basically, he found a dead person.
Mm-hmm. It's technically him.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay, so that makes
you all along.
Okay. That's a fair enough actually reason for why they were all split of that.
Not just that; it's a really good plot twist in concept. If only they took more time to focus on all nine of them.
Don't get me wrong,
I think that my main problem with this is that I get what you're going for, but I still think the characters could have been more developed.
Yeah, that's the main. Yeah. In fact, that's why I'd say that all of this movie's problems really start and end with how much they actually focused on the nine of them. It's like, well, honestly, I feel like this whole movie would be better if you just spent more time to focus on the characters.
Like, for example, number one represents his dickish side,
Hold on.
Okay.
Okay, so...
What are you going to say, Pedro?
Hold on.
The what? Oh, right, the talisman. So what is so special about that talisman?
It's the thing that allows the transfer of soul.
Yeah, we've never seen the scientist guy act like a big dick, did we?
Well, honestly, Dreams, it's part of his subconscious. Yeah. And also, remember, it's his pride as well.
Remember, Dweebs, psyche aspect in all of us are always present. It's just how we act and how our subconscious is formed that determines what aspect surfaces and what remains latent.
Uh-huh.
Okay, like I was saying, for example, number one is, of course, his dickish side, sure. My problem with that is that the movie doesn't really use number one for anything spectacular aside from just, you know, the guy who sometimes does dickish things.
Well, one shows off more of his pride, and, you know, of course, pride comes with leadership. That much makes sense. It's just when you get to Balance of Two, which, like I said, number two is really like nine. In fact, number one himself even states that two is exactly like nine.
Actually, that's another good point, actually. Two was pretty much just like nine, so...
But with a special hat that set him apart, but he lost that early on, now, didn't he?
It's really sad, because this movie could have been amazing if it had a better writer who took these concepts and developed them further. But again, like I said, maybe the rushed nature or limitations is probably the things to blame. Maybe Reeves,
that's also why they are afraid of pain, despite being, you know, just dolls, because they have a human soul being inside them. So, you know, that gives them the fear of pain.
Now I have to wonder.
Yeah, but even then though, these characters aren't really all that interesting.
I know. That's what I've been saying throughout the whole movie.
Exactly. It's like, well, if we'd focus more on them, they would be more interesting. But I do have to wonder, though, what part of the Doctor sees himself as a girl?
actually, Jova, it's...
At least now the Doctor's dickishness goes away.
Yeah. It's basically, Jova, it's a branch of psychology that tells that each person inside them as a fragment of the opposite
other gender.
The other gender's not personality, but you know, some part of the traits. That's what gives more some people more sensibility and others more dickishness.
I never saw it as I never saw it as anything gender specific. I just saw Seven as his adventurous side.
True.
Well, I get that. I'm just wondering why Seven's even a girl.
It's like, have you ever seen...
Well, Jova, we gotta have a strong female character in here somehow.
Have you guys seen Yu Yu Hakusho? Or Hakusho, whatever it's
called. Okay. I get what you're talking about.
It's basically the same thing as Shinobu Sensui.
Yeah. You've got a point, actually. You know, the whole feminine side, masculine side. So, wait, did he kill it?
Basically, yeah, he had to transfer the soul inside the talisman.
So he just took the souls from the machine and boom, that did it?
Yeah.
Huh. So that machine was literally powered by the Doctor's own soul, when you think about it.
Well, it makes sense, considering...
So, however, it was corrupted by the fact that it was supposed to be a war machine, and it was corrupted by the military's actions.
So, let's see, the ones left alive are...
You know what I want?
9, 7, 3, and 4.
You know, here's how I would have done this story, for example. If I was the one writing this story, I would have actually done it so that all 9 of them would be in extreme conflict because, you know, of their various different personality traits. One wants to do things more vengeance, one wants to be more careful, you know, that will generate a lot of character conflict, which of course makes for interesting drama. And then, when they all figure out that they're supposed to be 9 pieces of a whole, that makes them now working together a lot more satisfying as a result. That's how I would have done it.
What's the map from Treasure Planet doing here?
Close but no cigar, Joe.
But yeah, I guess I should be glad that at least 7 still alive.
Oh, is that 8? Or
yeah, yes. 8. 8 soul.
So they're going to bring him back to life or something?
Oh.
Basically, the machine, when absorbed them, so their souls trapped them, kind of.
There's 6.
Who's next?
Yeah, that's another thing. What's the difference between 3 and 4?
Well, 3 and 4 are literally twins. They're both having the same purpose and everything. And
one's odd, one's even.
By that logic, we should have just made only 8 of them.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's the gaming for every
of course.
Twins.
Next comes 2, or
and 5.
Weird how 5 is still missing his eye in the afterlife.
Well, I guess we're going by special edition logic, if Webbs knows what I mean.
I guess that's what you call a phantom pain, after all.
That depends. Which special edition are you talking about?
And here's one.
All right, well then.
You're done good, son.
Sorry for being a massive dickhead earlier.
I was filled with pride. I couldn't help it. So now they bring them back to life, right?
It's starting to remind me of the portal ritual in Beyond Two Souls.
Actually, that symbol, Pedro, looks like more the symbol of a firebomb attack from Pokemon.
Yeah, I know. Well, actually, isn't that symbol...
The kanji for fire?
Yeah.
I don't remember.
I think it is, actually.
Wait, so their souls ascend to the heavens and that's it?
Choir.
So they're still dead? What was even...
No, they're free.
They're now free to go to heaven or some shit.
I'm free!
When they were trapped inside the machine, they were just...
And now
trapped.
They've created a storm? Oh, now it's raining.
Yeah. Of course, this symbolizes new life and everything.
Yeah.
So, I guess that leaves only 4 fragments of humanity left, but I guess those other 5 were good for causing some rain.
Well, that's the thing, Jova. After this, basically, since the machines used weapons that killed everything, including plants and bacteria, now that the machines are gone, basically life can start anew, from plants to everything. There you go, from bacteria to everything again.
Well, I'll give this movie this, at least it didn't try to shoehorn in an environmental message.
By the way, water is good for you, and machines are bad. There you go, I've done it.
What the?
Oh,
just the credits.
So the credits were also stuck in there. Nice. All right, can I go first?
That is really weird.
This movie is what I like to call a noble failure. And I'm not going to be wrong. I'm not saying it's like a complete failure or anything like that. I'm just saying that it's such a noble attempt at filmmaking because you can tell the people who made this movie had a fantastic vision because this movie has so much potential. You can see it. You can see an amazing movie in here, bursting, fighting, struggling to come out, but it just can't quite do it because either the writer couldn't quite figure out how to make it all work together, or, and that's my number one theory for how this works, limitations, because I get the feeling this movie probably was intended to be longer, because it just feels like they stripped it down to the bare essence, removing all the character development scenes. That's what it feels like to me. But like I said, it's a noble failure because you can tell the people who made this movie were genuinely trying to create something awesome. But somehow it just didn't work out. But it has good points. 9, 7, and to a lesser extent, 8, are fairly decently characterized. Like I said, the artistic direction in the animation is fantastic, and the music is pretty great too. It saddens me because this is the worst kind of bad movie. The movie that could have been amazing, but it ended up try to make it amazing, but something horribly wrong happened during development. It's a commendable failure. So my heart out to the filmmakers because I really hope these people manage to somehow get a job for another and somehow manage to turn out a better work than this. Go ahead.
So like a remake of Assume.
I'm done.
Can I go next?
Go ahead.
Sure.
Okay. Honestly, this movie wasn't really all that. Isn't really all that great for me, honestly. I mean, there is a good effort presented here, but the problem is, as like Pedro said, something must have gone wrong somewhere. My guess is the script.
If you want to know, Dweebs, the movie has a 56% on Rotten Tomatoes.
That explains it then.
Their consensus is pretty much on point. Like, it looks gorgeous, but the plot is too simplistic for its own good.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a case where
and most of the characters, honestly, are just kind of there.
Yeah.
They have a bit of personality, but a bit's not really enough. The two I remember the most are that one voiced by Jennifer Connelly. And
seven
and biggest dickus
one.
Really? So you don't even remember Nine himself?
No.
I think the problem with Nine is that he's just kind of the rebellious dude, but he doesn't even talk much, which kind of prevents more character development.
So overall, sadly, this movie was a bit of a dud, I'm afraid.
Mm-hmm. But a noble dud. But won't you agree with me? It's at least a noble dud.
Well, there was effort put into it at least, which is more than I can say for some other bad films that I've seen. But
some quote unquote good films we've seen.
But overall, sorry, no.
Sure.
I'll go next.
I will get to making the poster of this for our thumbnail, actually. You guys continue.
Jeez, Dribs, do you ever want to leave a poster to me these days?
I'm doing the film posters, Jova. You can do the video game ones.
It's okay. Even if I don't like it, I could just refine it. I'll probably like it, though. Okay, my turn. Yeah, this is the kind of project where everything's good, except for almost everything to do with the writing. Yeah, I'm not kidding. I mean, the animation's great, the character designs are neat, the atmosphere is well shown, and the music is wonderful. It's just when it comes to the writing of both the story... Okay. Allow me to put it into two categories.
I think what you're trying to say is it has fantastic concepts, but it can't quite put them to good use. Right?
Not just that, but here's the thing. It kind of fails on two accounts when it comes to the writing. The storytelling and the character writing. When it comes to the storytelling, I could see maybe why they wouldn't focus on that as much, because you're like, well, this seems to be more of a movie that was demanding to be character-driven, going off of what I went to the trailer. The problem is that when it comes to the characters, it seems to be relying more on the atmosphere. Yeah, it's weird, but it seems like there's a bit of a yin-yang which doesn't work here. See, when it comes to the characters, really the only ones of note that you really need to pay attention to are 9, 7, 8, and 1. And no, I'm not counting 2. He was barely there, and heck, everyone even states he's basically 9, just with a cool-looking hat. 3 and 4 are quirky, I guess. They're like supposed to be the cute, mute characters who speak by clicking and all that stuff. 6 was a recluse in Prophecy for Tower, nice and all, but he didn't really do much up until his death. But yeah, it's like, what a shame. I really would have at least liked to have seen at least one scene where all nine of these characters would be together. I mean, heck, you've got such a great cast. Use them, dang it. Well, I mean, I guess you did, technically, but what about the guy playing two, whoever he was?
He was Martin Landau. It's a shame, was a good actor.
Yeah,
you get Martin Landau when you barely use him.
I mean, geez, that's like the many times I've seen these movies pull out a great singer and have them be the one person who doesn't sing. I mean, it's such a shame, too, because like I said, everything else is gorgeous about this movie. And figuratively speaking, when it comes to the atmosphere, it's gorgeously done, but it's obviously supposed to be grim. Also, kind of was a bummer that we never really get to see the aftermath of them finally solving the problem. It's like, we're just told it'll get better. And then, boom, credits. It's like, you know, usually these sort of movies show, like, an aftermath. Like, you know, things getting brighter and better. Ugh. But yeah, it's a noble failure. Beautiful crap, whatever you call it. Not quite like, say, Alpha and Omega, because Alpha and Omega didn't turn out that great. But I can definitely see, like, with Alpha and Omega, there's a lot of effort put into it. And by God, if it just had better writing, this movie would have succeeded. Well, better writing and a longer runtime.
Mm-hmm.
All right, I'm done. Good movie. Right. Well, fairly, it's decent. I'll give it. I'll just call it decent.
All right. Well, yeah, it's pretty much what you guys said. It's rushed, and it could have been so much better, but it was the short time and the odd pacing just bogged it down to a mediocre level. But I still enjoyed it for what it was worth. But yeah, I agree, it could have been better. Maybe a remake in the future, who knows?
Yep, I kind of enjoyed it too, mainly for the action scenes. But when it comes to the actual story, I've seen better done, I'll just say.
We'll see. Well, for now, that's pretty much it for this movie.
Yeah, the movie only made $48 million worldwide, so I'm afraid we'll probably never see a remake of this, sadly.
Oh, we might see a remake, like...
Well, Pedro,
Joe, we'll fund a remake for a movie that was kind of a commercial letdown.
Who said anything about
making remakes of everything. Bollywood is making remakes of everything these days, whatever they failed or succeeded, so...
Yeah. I wouldn't be too remiss to a remake, especially if Tim Burton wants to do it. Lord knows, he probably might want to.
Anyway, that's pretty much it for this movie. See you for the next themed Laika movie, probably.
Yeah.
See you then.
See you.